Hi there, John Porter from Trusted Reviews here, and today I'm joined by Sed, who is the TV dude. That's your job title, right? TV
yeah,
dude?
Yeah, TV dude.
TV dude here.
I do TVs.
Do TVs, yeah. In a kind of dude-y sort of way.
Yeah.
And here, so you're in charge of all the TV coverage here at Trusted Reviews. So we're going to be talking through the big two TV technologies around right
That's
now. QLED or OLED. Right, so like top line, what's the difference? Should people care?
Okay. QLED is a fancy term for LCD TVs that we've had for years. Most TVs on the market now are LCD, and QLED is basically Samsung's way of marketing these TVs because they've added a new fancy filter of quantum dots on top, which improves color and light management. But it's just an evolution of the same TVs that we've got everywhere else.
So it's like an LCD TV on steroids.
Elevated. It's TVs turned up to 11 as we traditionally know them. OLED are a completely different format. OLED TVs have organic material and each pixel lights itself up when charge is applied to them. So basically you've got each single pixel individually dimming and lighting up, as opposed to LCDs, which require a separate lighting unit, mm-hmm. either at the back or on the sides.
So QLED, pretty much the same as what we've got before, but made better. OLED, completely different tech. Which one's better?
If I had a dollar for every time I got that. There is no better, there's only different, and it's entirely dependent on how you live, how your living room is set up, because it's really down to you.
Okay, so describe to me the perfect living room for an OLED TV.
Okay, a black room, basically. OLED TVs are particularly strong in darkness because they can reach absolute blacks. Those pixels, when they're black, they're actually off. There's no light coming from them, which means they're really good at dealing with shadows. That's no good if you are in a bright showroom with, you know, a window next to your sofa and it's kind of reflecting off the screen. Light pollution is just a terrible thing for OLEDs. In a dark room, however, they are amazing. They are unbeatable. That's not realistic though, because plenty of people will watch with a lamp on, or, you know, I test TVs, but I can't help having a window at 45 degrees facing the TV. Even if I draw the blinds, there's still some light bleed. And that's where I find QLED to be very useful, because QLED's strengths lie in brightness.
Okay, so QLED, if you've got like a bright living room, you don't have blackout curtains, if you've got a lot of ambient light in your living room, then QLED might be a better option.
Yeah, I mean, these spotlights we have here, you could watch a TV with all of these shining on the TV and the QLED wouldn't break a sweat. It's that bright. We're talking about over 2000 nits of brightness, where 1000 nits is the maximum that OLEDs are rated for. So basically we're talking twice the brightness of OLED.
And then in terms of, obviously like brightness is one thing, but then colors, does either have like a distinct color advantage?
That's a tricky one. A lot of films are mastered with 1000 nits in mind, because a lot of people in Hollywood mastering studios, they don't want to blind you. They assume you're going to be watching it in cinema conditions. They assume you're going to be watching it in pitch black, in which case 1000 nits is enough. Samsung's argument is that the brighter a picture is, the more true to life it is, because you go outside, you're looking at light sources that are easily like 10,000 nits from, you know, street lamp or the sun. So it really depends on what you're watching. Sports fans, for instance, would probably prefer a QLED picture, especially when you have a brightly lit stadium with all the spotlights shining at people. That's not a cinematic picture, but it is a more realistic picture.
Okay. In terms of viewing angles, is there much difference between the two?
Viewing angles is one area where OLED consistently destroys QLED or LCDs in general. That's because you've got one single plane that is doing all the work. You've got very thin TVs. They're about 6 credit cards thick. And the light source is very close to the front, which means at any angle, you're just seeing the picture as it is. It's an emissive technology. The problem with QLED is that it's a transmissive technology, which means light has to shine through something. And when you shine light through something, you're limited by angles. you have to basically watch from a kind of central 30 degree sort of angle, and if you move outside of that, you'll start to lose out on brightness, you start to lose out on color. So if you've got a family spread out across the living room, then OLED wins every time.
But I've heard about a problem that OLED can have, which is burn-in. Is this a massive issue? What is it? Should people be worried about it?
Okay, can OLEDs burn in and leave basically like a ghostly image on your screen? Yes, they can. If you leave a news channel logo in the corner for like a day, or if you keep playing the same video game and you've got like a little map in the corner, over time, that will burn in. That will be kind of permanent. You can't just turn it off and hope it'll go away. But that's extreme. If you treat your TV like a normal person would, watch it a couple of hours and turn it off, it'll be fine. I've never actually seen a normally used OLED TV with burn-in.
Okay, so say I'm a gamer and I'm really into one game that has like a HUD that's there the entire time I'm playing, and I maybe play for like, I don't know, let's say something crazy, like 8 hours a day, then maybe it's gonna be an issue?
Then I would be a little nervous. Okay. Then I would say, okay, maybe go for QLED instead, because you know, they do offer, I think, a 10-year guarantee of no burn-in, which is pretty good. I'm not sure many of the OLED manufacturers are doing that at the moment, which kind of tells me about the industry confidence in OLED in general. It's not certain that you will or won't get burn-in, but the more you mistreat the TV, the longer you use static images on that screen, the higher the chance that you'll get some sort of retention.
You've already mentioned Samsung is firmly on the kind of QLED side. Who are the OLED manufacturers out there?
It's basically LG. LG Display makes pretty much all the screens for all the OLED TVs you get. So you've got Sony using LG Display screens, you've got Panasonic using LG Display screens. And that's actually the reason why you can probably find LG OLED TVs for a little cheaper, because they're selling that tech to everybody. They can afford to go a little lower. The Sony and Panasonic OLEDs tend to retain their prices for a little longer.
LG's making these panels, other people are buying them, and then like, just because like Sony's TV and LG's TV is using the same panel, does that mean the picture quality is the same, or are there differences between those TVs?
There are big differences, because the panel technology itself isn't everything. There's still all the, that's kind of the raw material. You still need clever processing to tell that picture what to do. And that really comes down to how a TV is tuned, what chips they're using, what sort of processes they're putting the pictures through when they come through from, say, Netflix or the 4K Blu-ray you're playing. I've reviewed the Sony AF8 this year, the LG C8 and the Panasonic FZ952 series. And they all use the same OLED panel, yet they look very different, and that's all down to tuning. Panasonic, for instance, puts a lot of value in their working relationship with Hollywood. So they go all out for color accuracy. LG likes to go for punch. So you could say their pictures look slightly less realistic, but they are more vibrant. You know? So if you want to get your friends around and show off you've got this new TV and it's OLED, that's probably gonna be more attractive at a glance. Sony is somewhere in the middle, and their thing is motion smoothness, motion handling. Same picture, technically, different results.
So all the flagships are using OLED, apart from Samsung, which is sticking to QLED, but Samsung still does use OLEDs, but for its phones, not its TVs. Why?
Well, Samsung did once make an OLED TV years ago, one, and that was it. They decided to stop doing it because OLED tech at the time was just too volatile, and they decided it wasn't worth it, it breaks too easily. And every time I ask them, they say the same thing. We're worried about burn-in. And you can say, well, okay, what about phones? They use static images all the time. Like you've always got the bar at the top, the bar at the bottom with the menus and all that. That's not good for it. But you turn your phone off, don't you? You turn your screen off every few minutes. I think they say the average person in the UK reaches for their phone every 12 seconds or something like that. Well, that means your phone is probably on and off all the time. That's a lot less likely to have a burn-in problem. Not to mention the phone cycles tend to be around, what, 2 years? You know, you replace a new phone. TVs tend to stay in the house for a good 5 years or so. Some people keep their TVs for 10. So in terms of longevity, they're not worried about mobile phones. They assume you're going to replace it or smash it sooner or later. TVs, less likely.
Final question. What would you say are the single best OLED TVs and QLED TVs on the market?
Okay, there's really only one choice for QLED at the moment. It's the flagship Samsung Q9 FN. That is really, really good. Really bright, really vibrant. And if you're the kind of person like my mum who, you know, leaves all the lights on all the time, like a showroom, then you're gonna love that TV. OLED, I'm a fan of the Panasonic, the FZ950 series, because if I'm gonna sit and watch things in a dark room, like in cinema conditions, I like the accuracy of those colors. It really does feel very cinematic.
So hopefully this video has given you guys a pretty good idea of the differences between OLED and QLED. So thank you so much, Sed, for talking us through all of that. And until next time, I've been John Porter from Trusted Reviews. See ya.